So UKIP were lying to us after all. Yeah, my name is Tony, but you've probably all seen me on television.
Yeah, no.
Not the Crime Watch reconstructions, no. About 25 years ago, I used to play Penfold in the Danger Mouse cartoon. More recently, you've probably seen me as Norris in Coronation Street. But I'd just like to start off with a thank you and a couple of apologies. A massive thank you for Peter for inviting me along and for putting this fantastic evening on. But I normally do poetry, and he asked me to do a stand-up set tonight, so I brought my iPad. Just in case I forget any of my key lines. But I'd also like to apologise for bringing me beer on stage, because some people find that a bit unprofessional. Just this afternoon, even at my ripe old age, I finally had my first ever blowjob. I'm not celebrating, I'm just trying to get to the fucking taste. I always do that joke very early on, I call it the barometer. Just to see what I can get away with. It does sound like you are a crowd of dirty buggers, so we should be honest. So, like every comedian you've ever seen on stage, we have to say this, I'm having an absolutely terrible week. Oh. A couple of days ago, my house was broken into by the world's most ironic burglar. He stole my kitchen sink, but fuck all else. Later on that same day, my wild goose ran away from home. I was going to chase him, but I thought, what's the bloody point? I ended up watching this really long and boring film about Buddhism. That's 3 hours of my life that I probably will eventually get back.
Oh, dear.
One of my friends tried to persuade me to become a Buddhist. I wasn't very keen at first, but I thought, fuck it, you only live once. Two reincarnation jokes, ladies and gentlemen. Both of them absolutely crap, but we'll be doing them again in 2014. Three reincarnation jokes. And to top it all, I had a really big argument with my girlfriend. Because I mentioned that she's putting on a bit of weight, big mistake. Because she is a bit fat, but she doesn't like to talk about it, so I always feel like there's an elephant in the room. So it turned into this absolutely huge argument, and in the end I said, will you still love me when I'm old and fat and ugly? And she said, of course I do. But I should warn you, like Mr. Gorgonzola, who entertained you brilliantly before, I'm also a Salford lad. So there are two Salfordians in the house. Hello, security. Could you please raise the terrorist alert from amber to red, please? I'm contractually obliged to do that with them, as there's two Salfordians on the bill. But I'm not going to diss Salford, because I'm a very proud Salfordian. In fact, I'm buying a house there at the moment. Yay. Went to the estate agent, as we call it round now, with the pound shop. And one of the estate agents very kindly showed me around the property the other day. She said, this is the gas cooker, this is the washing machine, here's the fridge freezer. Now would you like to take a look inside the house?
Oh, dear.
It was a bit of a dodgy catchment area. I heard this bunch of scallies on the street corner, and I'm not kidding you, it was effing this, effing that. They weren't swearing, they were just comparing the GCSE results. Sorry, just going back to the iPad. But, Salford's a city of culture, so I don't want to diss it. We've even got a university there. Yay. About 20 years ago, upgraded from a polytechnic. I think the decade before that was probably a Citizens Advice Bureau. But I'm a graduate of Salford University. I studied advanced ballet dancing. Came out with a 2-2.
Oh, dear.
Please don't throw a big... my brother was a bit less fortunate than me. He just went to the University of Life. With his A-level grades, it was either that or Salford. But it's a very cultural city. We've got museums. We've got a science museum with its own planetarium. It's got a massive hole in the roof anyway. We've also got a fashion museum with iconic clothes from the 1930s and 1940s. Although, to be honest, that's just a local branch of Primark. We've got theatres there, and just recently I saw an outdoor production of Shakespeare's Othello in the park. Very moving moment when Othello died at the end. Just that when I studied it at school, I always thought he committed suicide. In this production, he got the shit kicked out of him by six BNP skinheads. Although it did later transpire that wasn't part of the production. As well as being a very cultural city, Salford's a thriving commercial enterprise.
Is it?
Salford Precinct has now got 24-hour shopping. Well, we've got rioting and looting, but it's pretty much the same thing. Because some of you cosmopolitan, sophisticated Lancastrians, you were probably really surprised when you saw kids about this big on the CCTV footage stealing trainers from JD Sport. In fact, some of the kids nicking the trainers are younger than the ones who stitched them together in the first place.
Oh.
Politics. So what? I won't kid you, Salford is a bit of a crime capital, and I think the starting point is really the primary schools, because I've got two sons who went to a Salford primary school. It was so rough the monthly newsletter had its own obituary column. The school motto was, "Did you spill my pint?" And the official hint was, "You're going home in a fucking ambulance." Because I went to a Salford school myself, but the discipline was a lot tighter because it was a Catholic school. They had very severe punishments. My brother was talking to the lad behind him and they turned him into a pillar of salt. Which was okay, kept the slugs out of our house. My sister was caught snogging behind the bike shed, so the nuns gave her a burning bush. She was rubbing in the ointment for months. Every Monday morning, the priest used to come down to our school and make all the boys line up to tell him their impure thoughts. The official term was penance and confession. Father Murphy called it speed dating. But you can't blame it all on the school, because I think about some of the toys and games that the kids play, you know, the Call of Duty and the Grand Theft Auto. But even some of the traditional board games, you've got customised versions now. The Salford version of Monopoly. You buy two properties, set fire to them, and then claim on the insurance. Instead of a get-out-of-jail-free card, you get a sawed-off shotgun and a fake passport. You can get Salford Lego. They don't give you any wheels. You just put your cars onto four stacks of bricks. Salford Trivial Pursuit. That's called a visit to the job centre. Get Salford Transformers. I watched in amazement while my nephew turned a helicopter into a big plastic stick to twat his sister with. And in fact, especially for the girls, you can now get the Salford Barbie doll. You get two costumes to dress her in. You get pyjamas and slippers when she's ready for bed. A different coloured pyjamas and slippers when she goes shopping in London. You've all seen them.
Jesus.
Of course, you get the accessories, the tattoos, the 20 Lambert and Butler, the benefit book. And you can still get Ken to be Salford Barbie's boyfriend, but now he doubles up as her pimp. But the best thing of all, especially for the girls, you get six little boys to play with. You get David, and David. Obviously, that's going to get a bit confusing, so you might be better calling them David, Dave, Davey, Davo. Oh, fuck it, just use the six different surnames, it's far easier. Now we have gone over it, haven't we? But like Gordon Zola, I've tried to educate myself and bring a bit of culture into my life. Do a lot of reading. In fact, I know this sounds make me sound a bit geeky, but I do read dictionaries. Can be a bit frustrating. I spent 4.5 hours yesterday looking for the word camouflage. But I did stumble across the word contempt, and the definition said, "Don't you know what contempt means, you ignorant git?" Well, this is absolutely true. You can check it when you go home. Do you know what the word dictionary is actually in the dictionary? What is the fucking point of that? If you want to know how to spell it, you look at the front. Yeah. If you don't know what it means, how the fuck do you know where to look for it? Well, I'm quite an avid reader. About 10 years ago, I read Charles Darwin's Origin of Species. Left it on my bookcase for a decade, and when I looked recently, it evolved into a Kindle.
Oh, brilliant.
Reading a book at the moment called Low Self-Esteem for Dummies. Think about it. And I don't know if anybody's read Samuel Beckett's Waiting for Godot. There's a punchline to this joke, it just hasn't arrived yet. But my favourite novel, I do have to check this. Has anybody read To Kill a Mockingbird by Harper Lee? Yeah. Hopefully most of you, because I was really disappointed because I went to reread it recently and somebody had stolen it from my bookcase. I've got absolutely no firm evidence for this, but I reckon it was probably a blackfella. If you haven't read that book, it's very, very dodgy. Could be Reginald D. Hunter at the PFA Awards all over again. Especially 48 hours after Nelson Mandela died, but it has been vetted by The Guardian and it is politically correct. So, I thought I'd do a bit of culture because I'm claiming to be a culture vulture. So I'm going to form a few poems for you as well. They're going to be a couple of love poems. Because as you can probably tell by looking at me, I have been extremely lucky with the ladies.
Oh yeah. Sorry.
Nobody's ever caught me hiding in there. I've also got quite a bit of sexual chemistry. I prefer to call it Rohypnol. You can laugh at the Mockingbird joke. Shame on you. Just this afternoon, a really attractive girl referred to me as charming. Well, she mumbled it under her breath when I farted in the lift, but it still counts. I'll recite a few love poems for you. This first one is actually based on the work of William Shakespeare. Although I was reading recently, Shakespeare didn't really write any of that stuff he's supposed to have written. I think it was written by a shitload of Elizabethan monkeys at typewriters or something. Probably got my stories mixed up. This is called the Seventh of the Sonnet. Shall I compare thee to a summer's day? You're hot and sticky, with the possibility of damp patches in southern regions later. Took Shakespeare 14 lines to write that, I did it in two, so I have 7 times. And I wasn't going to bother doing this one, but well, it's called Commitment Issues. She said I was scared of commitment, so I took some professional advice. I had a really good counselling session, but I couldn't be asked going back twice. Oh. This one's called My Love Life in a Nutshell. I make love like a catalogue comes. I arrive in a jiffy every 2 months.
Oh, Jesus!
Oh. Well, I like you laughing at. It's what's called Untitled Love Poem. I'm in love with a lady joiner at a local hardware store, but every time I enter, she makes a bolt for the door. Oh. It's what's called Brutal Honesty. You asked, does my bum look big in this? And I tried to be diplomatic, but you were in the living room and your ass was in the attic. That one's another true story. I'll end on a couple of dodgy ones, because then I can get off quickly. This one's called STD LOL. When flirting at the clap clinic, your chat up lines must soften, so I probably wouldn't open with, do you come here often? You've been an absolutely lovely crowd. I'll leave you with this one. People ask me where the inspiration for my poetry comes from, and I suppose it's a combination of the passionate politics of William Blake, the forensic structure of a Philip Larkin, and the romantic beauty of William Wordsworth and the Lake Poets. So this one's called Rubbishing for Telltale Lumps in My Big Hairy Bollocks. As all men know, there's fuck all scarier than an unexpected object in the bagging area. Oh.